Hello everyone, my name is Nachiketa and welcome back to another video. In this video, I'm going to show you how you can implement the Keras library to implement transfer learning on any of your image classification problem. I have previously made a video on this using the VGG19 model. In this, I'm going to show you how to do it using the ResNet 50 model. And in this video, I'm going to be using a much simpler code and I'm going to guide you through the complete process from obtaining a data set, preparing the images, giving it to a model, how you can exactly fine tune a state-of-the-art neural network, and finally how to evaluate the model, visualize its metrics, as well as make predictions on new data. So I'm going to guide you through the complete flow. So let me just first give you a gist of what transfer learning is. So what Keras has done, right, it has made available state-of-the-art neural networks like Exception, VGG16, ResNet 50, and all of these models have been trained on the ImageNet data, which basically contains millions of images. So whatever this model has learned, all of the weights can be transferred and used for your own image classification problem. That is why it's called as transfer learning, because you're basically transferring the learning of these models. So let me just show you how you can implement it and you'll understand it as we go through the code. So the first step is to import all the libraries. I'm going to explain them when we come to them in the code. So of course, to start with, you need a data set. So you can have your own data set, but for now I'm getting images from this TensorFlow URL of flower photos, which are basically images of different types of flowers. So in this line, I'm basically fetching data set from the URL that I mentioned, and I'm saving it into a folder called as flower_photos. And if I print the directory, you can see that the data set is going to be stored over here. And now let me just print and show what kind of an image we're dealing with. So this is how a rose image looks like. So the only thing you need to execute this code is a folder of images. So in the flower_photos, there's a folder by the name of roses. Similarly, there's gonna be a folder for each class of flowers. For your data set, make sure you have a folder of all the images. Once that is done, here's where we're gonna be splitting the data set into training and testing and doing some other pre-processing. So we use the image_dataset_from_directory class. And what this does is it takes the directory of the images, and here you can mention what should be the training and validation split. So right now what's going to happen is 80% of the data is going to be used for training and 20% for validation. Here I've mentioned that the first subset is going to be training, and when I write label mode is categorical, basically means there are different classes and categories of classes, and you have to mention the image height and width. So in your folder there are going to be a lot of images and they can be of different dimensions. So what I've done is all the images are going to be resized to a dimension of 180x180. You can change it to any dimension you want, and I've also specified the batch size of 32 over here. If your system has a lower RAM, you might want to reduce it to, let's say, 8 or 4. Similarly, the same code for the validation part. The only difference is I'm mentioning the subset as validation, and you can see that around 734 files are being used for validation and 2900 files are going to be used for training. So the splitting into training and validation is automatically going to be done for us. Now I am just printing what are the different classes inside my data set. So these are basically the names of all the folders in my data set. So there are 5 classes of flowers and my model has to learn to recognize all 5. So how do we exactly get state-of-the-art models and how do we fine-tune it to our model? Here is where that part comes in, and this is going to be very simple. First, what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be creating an empty neural network. I'm initializing by calling the sequential function, and this makes sure that the layers that are going to be added are going to be added in a sequence one after the other. So how do we get ResNet 50? So this is the code that does that. And where did I get this code? It's very simple. Simply go to Keras applications documentation and click on any model you want. So let's say I clicked on ResNet 50 and it gives you the code to import the model. Alright, so simply copy this and paste it. If you want to use some other model, Exception, Inception, you just have to do the same thing. So here is where I copy that part of the code, and I'm giving it the name as pre-trained_model. And there are some important things over here. Include _top equals to false. This basically means that I'm going to be using my own input layer and my own output layer. Why did I do that? Because the original ResNet model might have been trained on different image dimension. My image dimension is different, so that's why I write this parameter as false. And over here you have to mention the input shape of your data, number of classes, and you have to mention the type of pooling. It can be average or max, and which weights are you gonna be using. So the weights that was learned by training on the ImageNet problem, that is the weights that I'm gonna be using. Alright, so here I mentioned that for layer in pre-trained underscore model, which means that every layer inside that pre-trained model is not gonna be trainable, because I'm writing trainable is equal to false. So basically means that whatever the ResNet 50 model has learned, do not learn those weights again. Keep those weights as it is. I'm just gonna be adding my own input layer, my own output layer, and there the learning process is gonna be done. But whatever the ResNet 50 model has learned, that is not gonna change. This basically saves a lot of time complexity in the training process. So now what I'm gonna be doing is, I'm gonna be adding this pre-trained model to ResNet model that I created over here. So now I'm basically flattening whatever the model gave it into one dimension, and I'm using some fully connected layers at the end. So you can add 3-4 layers if you want. So these 512 neurons that I'm adding, these are the ones that are gonna be learning the new weights, right? The rest of the weights in the hidden layers are gonna stay the same. And I've mentioned the activation function as ReLU, and the final output layer has 5 neurons because there are 5 classes, and the activation function is softmax. So once you run this, it's going to download the model from the Kerasa application, and over here you can see the summary. So initially we have the pre-trained ResNet 50 model. To that we added our final fully connected layer of 512 neurons, and you can see the effect over here. This was the total number of parameters, and these are the trainable parameters. Rest of the parameters are non-trainable, right? Because model is not going to learn that again, because ResNet 50 has already learned it, right? So we don't need to do the training again for those hidden layers. Now once your model is ready, you simply have to compile it. You have to provide it one optimizer. I'm using Adam. I'm using a loss function of categorical cross entropy, and the metrics is going to be accuracy. Once you run this, you simply have to fit the model. You have to provide it the training data set and the validation data set, and you have to specify the number of epochs. And I noticed that I only needed 10 epochs for a good accuracy, but you can increase that number as well. So I've already trained the model. I'm not training it again because it takes some time, but you can see that with different epochs, the accuracy was increasing, and it seems to have overfit a little at the end. And the training accuracy is 100% and the validation accuracy is 88%. And if you want to experiment with this, you can change the output layers. You can reduce the number of neurons from 512 to, let's say, only 64, or you can add multiple layers as well. So that is for you to experiment with. And now let's visualize the output and the learning part of the model. So basically what I've done is I had stored the model's logs in a variable called as history, and basically I'm accessing the accuracy and the validation accuracy, and these lines just play the role of labeling the graphs. So once you run this, you can visualize the training accuracy in the blue line and the validation accuracy. Similarly, I'm going to plot the loss of the model as well. So the loss was declining somewhat for the training, but for the validation it was not declining that much, but the overall accuracy was still pretty good. So I'm not really worried about this for now, but it seems that there's a slight bit of overfitting. Now once your model is ready, how do you actually make the predictions? You just have to understand a little bit of pre-processing over here. So for now, I'm going to be using the CV2 library to read images. So my images were stored in this directory, and I'm going to be using the imread function to read images from this directory. And one important thing is over here to resize the image. So I'm resizing it to 180 x 180 because that's what my model had learned. And over here, I'm expanding the dimension of the image to make it 4-dimensional. So when I print it, you can see the shape of the data is 1, 180, 180, 3. This is important. To make prediction, your data has to be 4-dimensional, because it did not train on one image, it trained on multiple images at a time. So it is important to make it 4-dimensional. Once that's done, you can simply call your model, and you have to give your image and make the prediction. So once I print this, right, it will give me an array of numbers, because the softmax gives the probability for each class. But I'm only interested in the maximum probability, so I use np.rmax, and whatever index was corresponding to in the original class names array, that is what the output class is going to be. So when I print this, I see the predicted class is going to be roses. Alright, so this is the steps that you have to follow when you want to make predictions using your pre-trained model. And that was all for this video. If you did like this video, do like it and subscribe to this channel. I'm going to be making a lot more videos on similar topics, and see you in the next video.